सेल डेथ एंड नेक्रोसिस स्टडीज व्हाट हैपेंस इन सेल्स एंड दीज आर द प्रोसेसेस व्हिच रिमेन कॉमन थ्रू आउट पैथोलॉजी एट टिश्यू लेवल. बट वी फर्स्ट स्टार्ट विद अ सिंगल सेल एंड सी व्हाट हैपेंस टू इट व्हेन इट अंडरगोस इंजरी. So the standard disclaimer that this is a number of images which are used are taken from books which are referenced or taken from internet where the source is written below the image and is properly credited and is meant only for teaching purposes. Now, although I told you that Robbins is your standard textbook, a lot of the images I'll be showing you in general pathology are from this book by Majno and Joris. Cells, tissue, and disease. So, what is a normal cell? A normal cell is one in which the normal metabolic functions of the cell are going on, which means that the physiology and biochemistry which you studied in your previous lecture, in your previous semester, they are going on. There are certain physiologic demands which are being met. So, there is a need for some amount of energy, there is a need for some amount of nutrients. Which are, for example, insulin. You have studied how the action of a hormone is important in glucose metabolism. So that comes as part of normal homeostasis. So normal physiologic stresses are handled by the normal homeostasis. When the stress increases beyond normal physiological limits, there is an adaptation of the cell. For example, if you do extraordinary exercise, your muscle hypertrophies and becomes bigger. If you don't exercise the muscle, it atrophies and becomes smaller. So like that, you will study the cellular adaptations in subsequent lectures. Now, there is a stress which is more than the adaptation limit of the cell. And there is a point of no return, stress of such an extent that it causes cell injury. That is called cell injury. So, acute reversible injury is what starts off the process. It becomes irreversible. And if it is irreversibly injured, then the cell dies. And this is a process of cell death. So, let's look at some definitions. Normal cell, the physiological demands are handled normally. In cellular adaptation, the demands exceeding physiological are made on a cell and it changes to a new altered state where it still is able to adapt to the demands. Cell injury is a sequence of events following the delivery of a stimulus to a cell which exceeds the adaptive capacity. Some more definitions are in order. The two of which are most important are hypoxia and ischemia. So hypoxia is a standard model to study is cell injury. Hypoxia means loss of oxygen supply. So ischemia means loss of blood supply. So blood contains other nutrients. It contains glucose and it also washes away carbon dioxide and metabolites. So if you stop the blood supply, those also stop. Whereas hypoxia means only oxygen is lost. Some more terms. Necrosis is cell death in living tissue because of an injurious agent which is external to the cell, whereas apoptosis is cell death by activation of internal death program. Autolysis is changes in cells and tissue after removal of organ or death of organism. It actually is different from what happens in cell injury. We'll cover a little bit of it subsequently. So the list of injurious agents is very large, physical, chemical, infectious, immunological, genetic, nutritional and all. But the standard injury is hypoxic injury model. So hypoxia means loss of oxygen supply to tissues and can be either because ischemia, that is loss of blood supply, or a cardiorespiratory failure causing inadequate oxygenation of blood. That means, for example, if there's a myocardial infarction, blood flow can reduce to such an extent that you get a cardiogenic shock. So oxygen cannot be delivered to the tissue and the kidney, for example, may undergo a cell injury in the kidney because it's very sensitive. Similarly, hypoxia can be produced by other reasons like loss of oxygen carrying capacity in the blood. For example, there may be anemia. So the amount of hemoglobin is less. oxygen cannot be carried, or carbon monoxide poisoning. That means that the oxygen, instead of oxygen, carbon monoxide is binding, and therefore it is unable to carry oxygen to the tissues. Or acute blood loss. You had a road traffic accident, you bled out, the amount of blood is too less, so you get a hypoxic shock. You learn this, but in all of this, there is a reduction in the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood. Physical agents can be like mechanical trauma, like in an accident. It can be heat, burns, cold injury, radiation injury, electricity, electric shocks. Atmospheric pressure can increase or decrease. That also causes injury. Large number of chemical agents, which could be hypertonic physiological substance like oxygen or glucose in excess, or hypotonic solution like water itself can be an injurious agent. The list of toxic substances is very large, of course. Infectious agents can produce injury, like for example, your COVID can go and injure the epithelial cells of the upper respiratory tract. Immunological response, again looking at COVID, if you see, the cytokine storm produced by the immunological reactions to the agent cause more injury rather than cure the disease. So that is also a reason for injury. What about genetic rearrangement? So in hereditary diseases, there are changes in the cell which render the cell incapable of normal homeostasis and unable to adapt to the physiological stimuli. And that produces injury of that cell. Even normal demands can injure the cell. Or there could be a nutritional imbalance, like deficiency of vitamins, or an excess like overeating, obesity. So in the hypoxic model of cell injury, what happens is that this is the cell and this is the mitochondria. The purpose of mitochondria is to use the oxygen and the glucose and to generate lots and lots of ATP, which is responsible for maintaining all the functions. Large quantities of ATP are produced all the time and continuously. The moment oxygen is not there, this ATP generation stops. Now, another function of blood flow is that the carbon dioxide and other wastes are also removed. So the mitochondrion is the essential component. All eukaryotes, all multicellular organisms require mitochondrion to generate sufficient ATP for functions of the cell to be maintained. Okay. And glycolysis itself is inadequate. It can only keep bacteria alive. It cannot keep a eukaryotic cell alive. So loss of mitochondrial ATP generation is central to cell injury, because there are lots of functions of ATP. It maintains a normal cell membrane function. So you know about the membrane potential and the sodium potassium pump, the Na plus K plus ATPase, whose function is to throw out 3 sodium and taking 2 potassium. So it throws out more sodium than normal, but that is required because the cell is full of proteins. Eukaryote has it evolved by keeping cells within itself. So every prokaryote, every eukaryote has to actively export sodium so that the proteins can be kept together functioning as a unit inside the cell, whether it's a bacteria, whether it's a cell. And the same holds true in multicellular organisms like ours. So without ATP, this membrane function will stop. All other membrane transport also requires ATP. Synthesis of membrane proteins requires ATP. Synthesis and functions of phospholipids requires ATP. Maintenance of normal cell membrane function is the most important function of ATP, but it is also responsible for sequestering calcium from the cytoplasm into the mitochondrion, because mitochondrial membrane has this calcium magnesium ATPase, the function of it. So you want proteins to function in the cytoplasm, and the control mechanism is frequently calcium. So the precise regulation of calcium in the cytosol is required, and that is done by the mitochondria. Mitochondria removes the excess calcium so that optimal calcium for protein function is maintained in the cytoplasm. Other functions of ATP are protein synthesis by the ribosomes and polysomes, maintenance of normal DNA function in the nucleus, that is normal transcription. Cytoskeleton, that is actin, tubulin, these all require ATP to function. And proper folding of proteins in the endoplasmic reticulum requires ATP. Otherwise, the proteins will misfold. So all, practically every single cell function requires ATP. That's why it's called the energy currency of the cell. So what happens if you lost the ATP? ATP is not there because the oxygen is no longer coming. Mitochondria are not producing ATP. So sodium potassium pump will stop working. So if the sodium is not being thrown out, the oncotic pressure inside the cytosol is very high because of the proteins. And therefore, water comes into the cell and the cell swells up. That's why it's called cell swelling. The protein synthesis will completely stop because ATP is required, which means that all the ribosomes and polysomes will disaggregate. Now, if ATP from mitochondria is not coming, anaerobic glycolysis can still go on. So lactic acidosis from glycogen depletion will start. So because of this acidosis, so all the glycogen in the cell will deplete and lactic acid will be produced, and lactic acid will produce a clumping of chromatin. So normal chromatin is a opened out chromatin, and in acidic pH, instead of the alkaline normal 7.4 pH, it becomes clumped. Then the cytoskeleton will disrupt. So all the surface projections like cilia, which is because of polymerized tubulin, will be lost. Microvilli, which are produced by actin filaments, they will be lost. And the cell will lose its function. What, for example, a muscle cell, within 30 seconds of blood going to, suppose heart is there, the heart muscle is continuously contracting. If you stop the blood flow to the heart, glycolysis will keep it alive for 30 seconds. After that, even that ATP is gone and the cell will stop functioning. And this is what the injured cell will look like. So this is a normal cell. These are the microvilli. So it's a smooth, it has a particular shape in cell culture. This is rounded up because it's in a cell culture. And then if you injured the cell, it has become swollen. So blebs have come out. So water has gone into the cell and the blebs have come out. And it looks like this from outside. So this is the normal cell. It can have microvilli like this. The microvilli are because of activity of the actin microfilaments. Actin is gone, these villi go away. The phagocytic and pinocytotic functions of the cell will go away because of the lack of ATP. Cilia will depolymerize. Tubulin will depolymerize and the cilia will be lost. Okay. Then the endoplasmic reticulum will swell up. The glycogen of smooth endoplasmic reticulum will go away. The rough endoplasmic reticulum will lose its roughness because the ribosomes stop associating with it. And the whole cell will swell up. The only thing which will be holding it together are these cell junctions. So this is from your Robbins. This is what a normal cell looks like. And this is a diagram of what you saw previously, how this swollen cell looks like. So the membrane has blebs. The endoplasmic reticulum is swollen. Then mitochondria undergo a little bit of swelling. And something called lipid peroxidation starts producing myelin figures. We will come to this later. So if you look at an EM, this is the nucleus. These are the mitochondria and these are the endoplasmic reticulum. So endoplasmic reticulum in a normal cell is systematic and has a structure. So this is in a protein secreting cell and therefore there are lots of RER. Here what has happened is a cell injury. So the endoplasmic reticulum has swollen up. So early swelling of endoplasmic reticulum is the first sign of injury. This is the mitochondria. Mitochondria also are showing a little bit of swelling and there is some disarray of the cristae, but it's not a severe swelling. So normally polysomes are aggregated in small strands. So they are so mRNA in the cytoplasm is actively translating proteins over here. If there is injury, no ATP, the proteins, the ribosomes will disaggregate. They are just evenly distributed everywhere. This is the rough endoplasmic reticulum. All along the surface of the rough endoplasmic reticulum, we have ribosomes. And here, this is the ribosome and the this is the RER, and the rough part or the ribosomes have gone away from this. They are just lying in the cytoplasm like this. The cilia get lost because the tubulin will depolymerize and it will get shed and lost. But all of this which we have talked about is reversible. Okay. So if oxygen supply is given back to the cell, mitochondria will immediately start producing ATP again. As soon as ATP is produced, the sodium potassium ATPase will function again. It will throw out the sodium. And once sodium is thrown out, the water will leave along with the sodium. So the swelling will go away. As soon as ATP is made available, the ribosomes will aggregate again and protein synthesis will return. So these are molecular motors. On their own, they have a habit of associating together, because that is the way the evolution has produced this. They are magically almost joined together. If the energy is there, they will, these nanomotors will come together and associate with each other by nature. As soon as the actin function recovers, the microvilli will come back. So the enterocyte will again throw out the microvilli. Tubulin will repolymerize and the cilia which had been shed will reappear. So if fresh tubulin will be synthesized, the protein function returns. We'll come to heat shock proteins and protein synthesis also starts. So fresh tubulin will be made, which will make the cilia reappear. And then normal cell function will start again. So it will go back to being normal. That's why it's called reversible. So what are heat shock proteins? Heat shock proteins are expressed under ER stress. ER stress means that there is no ATP and so proteins are misfolding. So these proteins are expressed in these injured cells and they bind to the damaged proteins. Now a damaged protein has a tendency to misfold and this is prevented by the chaperon. So heat shock proteins are also chaperones. So stressed protein, so we cannot resynthesize all the proteins which are there in the cytoplasm. You need to resynthesize it. So we don't want to resynthesize it. So this is how you recover the proteins. So the stressed proteins are rescued by this mechanism and the function of the protein is preserved. But if the protein is irretrievably damaged, then ubiquitin will mark that this is a damaged protein and it is degraded in the proteasome, of which you must have read. It will anyway be covered in your, I think, autophagy lecture and other lectures. So what is irreversible injury? If everything is reversible, if mitochondria regain their function, irreversible injury means there is irreversible damage to the mitochondria. The mitochondria have gone. So the capacity to produce adequate ATP requires mitochondria, and when mitochondria are irreversibly damaged, the cell is also irreversibly damaged. When does a mitochondria get irreversible damage? When irretrievably there is loss of mitochondrial membrane protein function. There is severe damage to the mitochondrial membranes by the free radicals, so it cannot recover its function. The mitochondrial membrane, you must have studied in your biochemistry, is the most important part for the electron transport. The activation of certain phospholipases can destroy the mitochondrial membrane. Then there is severe mitochondrial swelling with complete disruption of the cristae structure and functional proteins. And finally, a massive influx of calcium can irretrievably poison the mitochondria. So this brings us to another aspect called reperfusion injury. So we just saw that if the blood flow comes back, mitochondria will produce ATP. But remember that calcium is an extracellular ion. It is there in the blood. It is kept low in the cytosol by a calcium sink, that is the mitochondrion. So if blood flow returns, lots of calcium is delivered to the cell. So if extracellular ion calcium is delivered to an injured cell, the injured mitochondria has reduced capacity to sequester the calcium. So we'll come to this MPTP or the pores in a subsequently, but essentially, when the pores are open, it's the end of the mitochondria. So calcium concentration in the cytoplasm now rises to higher levels where protein function cannot take place because the mitochondrial sink activity of mitochondria has finished. So calcium now activates a calcium dependent phospholipase in the cytoplasm and the membranes. And this will digest all the membranes and run amok and kill the cell. That's irreversible injury. Reperfusion also delivers oxygen, and it is from oxygen that free radicals are generated. We'll see what are free radicals. So coming back of oxygen produces ATP, but it also can cause oxygen derived free radical damage or reactive oxygen species, ROS. So in irreversible injury, mitochondria are irreversibly damaged. The mitochondrial permeability transition pore opens. So that means when the pores open, just like in Harry Potter, eye open at the close, at the end. So similar to that, the pores of the mitochondria, when they open, it signals the end. So this is also linked to apoptosis. When I come to the lecture on apoptosis, I'll tell you about it. So there is a lethal rise in cytoplasmic calcium. Profound loss of cell membrane function. That's another aspect of irreversible injury. Then the nucleus can get irreversibly damaged. That means that there is so much damage that the nucleus cannot recover its function, especially if there are nicks in the DNA which are beyond the capacity to repair. That is in free radical damage, which I'll just come to. Similarly, irreversible injury happens when the lysosomal contents are released. So the lysosome contains chemicals which can, I mean, enzymes which can digest all constituents of the cytoplasm. They have to be kept sequestered. If they are damaged, these enzymes, nucleases, proteases will digest everything. Cell is completely damaged. Last is the extensive free radical damage. So this is irreversible injury. So this was the original irreversibly injured cell. Now, nucleus is irreversibly damaged, severe swelling of endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria are irreversibly damaged with amorphous densities, breakdown of the plasma membrane, organelles, leakage of its content, and it also elicits inflammation, which will come to. What does it look like? There is severe swelling of mitochondria on EM. Amorphous densities in mitochondria are formed because of precipitated proteins and calcium, which associate together. There is extensive myelin figures, which indicates this free radical damage. There is karyolysis and karyopycnosis, which is seen on light microscopy. So severe swelling of mitochondria has taken place. Crystal structure is completely gone. See, cristae are no longer properly visible in the mitochondria. And here is a very old picture. We used to have a teaching set from which I've taken. So this is on EM. Amorphous densities in the mitochondria have come. So what are these free radicals? So free radicals are chemical species with a singlet unpaired electron in an outer orbital. They are very unstable chemicals. They react with other molecules, but they are autocatalytic, which means that molecules interact with free radicals and are in turn converted to free radical. That means that the free radical will attack a chemical bond, break the chemical bond, and at the end of this reaction, still an electron, unpaired electron is still left in an outermost orbital, which can again attack another chemical bond. So they run amok, they can destroy all the chemical bonds. So free radical damage, most important is peroxidation of lipids, which we'll come to. They can also cross-link proteins by the formation of disulfide bonds. So just like formalin fixes the tissue, free radicals also, you can say they fix the tissue almost, because they don't do it as much as formalin, but they cross-link all the proteins and make them dysfunctional. Free radicals also nick the DNA. They can break the DNA. Single strand as well as double stranded DNA damage is produced. They are generated by numerous methods which are listed here. I will give you a handout where they are all listed. But essentially, radiation can split water to generate free radicals. Mitochondrion generates H2O2, OH dot, which is a free radical, hydroxyl, and superoxide from the electron transport chain. Myeloperoxidase is a neutrophil enzyme whose function is to generate hydrogen peroxide, which can be a free radical. Xanthine oxidase can generate O2 singlet oxygen. There is a reaction called Fenton reaction. So all metals have the ability to stay in more than one valency state. So they can donate an extra electron to molecules and make them free radicals. So because, for example, iron can be 2+ or 3+. So the extra electron can form a hydroxyl radical. Nitric oxide synthase also generates radicals. Peroxynitrite anion or ONO minus is another free radical. And peroxisomes. Peroxisomes are the P450 enzyme containing microsomes of the liver. And from various detoxifying methods for chemicals like CCl4 or carbon tetrachloride, it can generate free radical like CCl3 dot. So the dot in all of this indicates a singlet oxygen, which can be donated to break bonds. So generation. After generation comes propagation. So you can remember the free radicals are oxidizers. The unpaired electron will cross-link molecules, leaving an unpaired electron at the end of the reaction. This causes lipid peroxidation of membranes, cross-linking the cytoplasmic proteins at sulfhydryl groups, and DNA breaks. So these are all the locations where they are produced. So lipid peroxidation happens in the cell membranes. Then peroxisomes have the another generating methods. The electron transport systems of the P450 and mitochondria. Then myeloperoxidase in the lysosome, the mitochondrion electron transport, all these generate the free radicals. So free radicals essentially can completely disrupt and disorganize a cell. And so you obviously want to stop it. So there are various methods to stop it. Antioxidants like vitamin E, A, C, and glutathione stop by acting as electron sinks. Metal binding proteins, which contain metals, they can act as an electron sink because they can take up the extra electron. So transferrin, ferritin, lactoferrin, ceruloplasmin. Then various enzymes like superoxide dismutase, catalase. So superoxide dismutase gets rid of the superoxide and makes hydrogen peroxide. Catalase gets rid of the hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen. Glutathione peroxidase gets rid of the hydrogen peroxidase by using GSH, which forms GSSG and water. And this GSSG, from that glutathione reductase, gets back the GSH by using the electron transport through the NADPH. So these antioxidants are present in the same places where the generation is going on. So the peroxisomes will have the catalase, cell membranes will have the vitamin E, even your endoplasmic reticulum and mitochondria will have vitamin E, cytoplasm will have vitamin C, vitamin C, E, and beta carotene are there in the lysosomes. So wherever there is generation, there is also the free radical sinks or termination methods. So what is lipid peroxidation? Lipid peroxidation means that just like any free radical, there is initiation. So superoxide can cut the PUFA. PUFA is polyunsaturated fatty acid. So they have a double bond with a bend. They will attack the double bond and break the double bond. So PUFA dot is formed. That means there's a free electron here. This free or with oxygen, it will form PUFA OO dot, which will cross-link with other PUFA OO to form PUFA OO PUFA, which means that this is a polymerized PUFA. So normal lipid bilayer requires that the cell membrane should have these in a particular form. If you cross-link all the phospholipids, then it just winds itself up and becomes a myelin figure. Are you able to free radical reaction? So this is what a myelin figure looks like. So instead of a lipid bilayer, it has formed into an onion skin like thing. Lipid bilayer has wound itself up like this. So CCl4, as we said, is also a free radical damager. So what happens is, so this is a normal phospholipid. There's a double bond here. So there is an angle. This double bond is broken by the free radical. and then these two phospholipids can react with each other and polymerize, and some bits are broken off and go away. So this completely disrupts the membrane. Other injurious agent, I listed a long list. Physical will disrupt the cell directly. Radiation causes injury mediated by free radicals and direct DNA damage. Chemicals, hypoxia can be produced by carbon monoxide. Mercury poisons all the SH groups of the proteins and causes protein dysfunction, which again leads to ATP damage and other forms of cell injury. Paracetamol poisoning is a toxic metabolite generated from microsomal P450, which depletes the glutathione. So the ability to stop free radical damage is reduced. Then free radical generation is seen in many chemicals like CCL4 by the microsomal P450. So if the liver is damaged, apoprotein synthesis is stopped and you get fatty liver. I'll cover this in the cell adaptation. So if you have understood the mechanisms which underlie cell injury, we'll look at what injured or dead cells look like. So we talked about irreversible injury. An irreversibly injured cell is going to die, and cell death in living tissue is called necrosis. If there is an endogenous activation of program, that is apoptosis, which is a subsequent lecture. Autolysis means changes in cells and tissue after removal of organ or death of an organism. So it tends to look different from just a normal necrosis. You don't get necrosis in autolysis. Mostly what you get is release of lysosomal contents which digest, and so cells tissue becomes kind of semi-liquid or liquefied in autolysis, unfixed tissue that is. An infarction is necrosis due to ischemia. So apoptosis is complete. So cell injury causes cell swelling process. Apoptosis is like a cell condensation process. So we'll come to apoptosis in a subsequent lecture. So the morphology of irreversible injury we already studied. Hydropic swelling, surface blebs, loss of microvilli, nuclei are normal. Up to this point, it is reversible. Irreversible injury shows only EM changes early, and later changes are the morphology of necrosis. So this is early injury. So the kidney tubules have undergone hydropic swelling. So this is a normal tubule. Here it is swollen up with water. So it is still reversible. If the oxygen supply is returned, these cells will come back to normal. So this is called hydropic swelling, or you can call it cloudy swelling. Again, you can see kidney tubules, they have become swollen. The cells have become full of water. It becomes clear. Instead of having the normal pink, it becomes white because there is water. So liver also is showing cloudy swelling or ballooning degeneration. This liver cell is swollen up. So this is all reversible. Nucleus is normal. When it becomes dead, you get the morphology of necrosis. The cytoplasm becomes eosinophilic. This is because the mRNA is lost. No more mRNA is present because the transcription is lost. Eosin is bound more by damaged protein. So it leads to cytoplasmic hypereosinophilia, darker staining. Because of release of lysosomal enzymes, the cytoplasm can become vacuolated. And nucleus undergoes changes called pycnosis, karyolysis, karyorrhexis. What is this? This is the normal nucleus. Pycnosis means that the nucleus has shrunk and become dark. Karyorrhexis means that it has become dark and it has broken up into many pieces. Karyolysis means that the nucleus has dissolved and disappeared completely. That is because of the action of endonucleases released by the lysosomal components. Okay, so the nucleus goes away. So loss of nucleus means it is a necrotic cell. Pycnosis and karyorrhexis are cells in the process of losing their nucleus. So this is what a kidney tubule, which has become, this is a hand drawing where the kidney tubule, it has got pycnotic nucleus. So normal nuclei are here. These are the pycnotic nuclei. The cells have started to shed from the surface, but the structure is still preserved. You can still see that the morphology of the tubule is still preserved. So here the nucleus has broken up. This is called karyorrhichis. This is karyopycnosis. Some of them, the nucleus has gone away. So this is karyolysis. So karyopycnosis, karyorrhichis, and karyolysis is going on. This is actual section. This is a relatively normal tubule. So see how the structure of the outline of the tubule is still present. So this is why it is called coagulative necrosis. Coagulate means the proteins are coagulated. So if this is normal, this is hypereosinophilic. The nuclei have gone away or in the process of going away. This is dark nuclei. So this is all dark nuclei. This is a pycnotic nuclei. So pycnosis, and this is karyolysis, and this is completely gone away. Karyolysis. So no nuclei. So cells without nuclei have undergone coagulative necrosis. Why do you call it coagulative? Because there are other types of necrosis also. Coagulative necrosis is like a tombstone, or the structure of the tissue is still preserved, but the cells look like they have lost their nucleus. Liquefactive means that the lysosomal activity is more. For example, in brain infarcts, there are lipases which will dissolve the myelin. Or if you have an abscess, the neutrophil contents will dissolve the tissue and kill themselves also in the process. And so it will get liquefied. So you get a tissue which becomes like liquid. If it is liquid, you can't fix it, you know, because the tissue is unfixable. It is a liquid. If you cut it, it will flow away. Then you have caseous necrosis. Caseous necrosis is a combination of coagulative and liquefactive necrosis in tuberculosis. And there is also presence of a third component, which is the mycolic acids derived from the cell wall of the tuberculosis. A peculiar kind of necrosis called caseous or cheese-like necrosis. Other types of necrosis are enzymic fat necrosis, gangrene, and fibrinoid necrosis, which I'll just explain. So fibrinoid necrosis is not a real necrosis. It's just deposition of immunoglobulin, which looks like a vessel has necrosis, and so we call it fibrinoid necrosis. Fibrinoid because fibrin-like material, mostly immunoglobulins and immune complexes. So necrosis always elicits an acute inflammation because there is expression of DAMPs or damage associated molecular patterns. And when you come to your inflammation, you will be taught all about this. Similarly, sequestered proteins and lysosomal contents always elicit an inflammation. And another thing which happens is that the enzymes and proteins are released into the blood. For example, if the heart is damaged, the necrotic heart cell releases its content, which includes troponin, into the blood. And so if you do a test for troponin, which is never present in the blood, you know that the heart has been damaged and markers of its necrosis are now present in the blood. So that means heart has undergone an infarct, myocardial infarction. So a heart infarct is showing coagulative necrosis. So coagulative necrosis looks yellowish in color. Normal color is pink like this. And here it has become yellowish like this. There's an area of hemorrhage over here also. So this area has undergone coagulative necrosis. This is also the same. This is heart muscle. This is a fat, epicardial fat, which also looks yellow. And this is a coagulative necrosis. So progressively, this area will become liquefied. The longer it stays, after 2-3 days, it will start getting more liquefied. But in coagulative necrosis, they initially have an outline. So liquefaction ultimately clears out the area, and then inflammatory cells will come in. There will be inflammation and healing by fibrosis, which are covered in your next chapters. So what happens in a heart infarct? You will be shown slides of this later in your practicals. There is coagulative necrosis. So in early coagulative necrosis, this is normal heart muscle, and this is heart muscle which is looking more eosinophilic. That means these are undergone necrosis. That's why there is eosinophilia. Here, somewhat the nuclei are still present in some of these. Here, the nuclei have completely gone away, except some outlines here. So heart muscle, which is hyper eosinophilic, nuclei have gone away, and in the interface shows inflammatory cell infiltration. This is coagulative necrosis. Coagulative because the structure is still maintained. Then, related to time, you might get some changes in morphology. So after in 1 to 2 hours, you may not see any change, although there is irreversible injury. After 4 to 8 hours, nuclear and cytoplasmic changes start. After that, you get inflammation and hyperemic border. Hyperemia means congested border. There is a tombstone necrosis, that means that the structure of the tissue is still preserved. Subsequently, phagocytes will come after a few days. They will digest and remove the necrotic material because they are attracted to that area by the inflammation, and there is healing by scarring. You'll study all these processes later. So this is a kidney infarct. There is a coagulative necrosis. The structure is still there, but it has become yellow. So this is an infarct. There's necrotic coagulative necrosis in this area. Here also you can see. So some amount of blood supply from the capsular vessels have maintained the capsule. So it is still pink like this, although it's hyperemic. And then this part of this is completely necrotic. So this is coagulative necrosis. Wedge shape because an artery at this point must have got occluded. This is also coagulative necrosis. It will not always be wedge shaped exactly. Different kinds of geographic patterns can come. You can see it on the surface also. Coagulative necrosis looks like area or yellow area standing out. This is a hyperemic zone which you can see. This is because of congestion of blood vessels due to inflammation. If you look at a section of kidney, it will show the structure. There's a glomerulus there, but no nuclei visible. So this is a necrotic glomerulus. Another necrotic glomerulus. These are necrotic tubules. The nuclei have gone, but you can still see the tombstone or the marker of what it originally looked like. Same thing, coagulative necrosis of kidney. The tubules are all necrotic, no nuclei. Nuclei gone. Glomerulus, no nucleus. Tubules, hypereosinophilic, and no nucleus. So this is a necrotic coagulative necrosis because of infarction. This is a splenic infarct. So this is a large congested spleen. And these are two areas where there are infarcts. So there is a big infarct over here, and then there is a older infarct over here. So there are two ages. So this one is little pink in color, this one is more yellowish in color. This is a liver in which there is necrosis. So you can see all the karyopycnosis, the karyorrhexis, the karyolysis of the liver cells going on here. If you have a stroke, you get a liquefactive necrosis. And so this is a cystic area because it's liquefied. The brain had an infarct and the myelin got digested by the lipases, and some areas are completely cystic like this. This is a brain abscess. So this area got infected by microorganisms. Inflammatory cells came in. They digested the brain tissue by releasing the neutrophil lysosomal constituents, created a big cyst-like or a vacant area full of liquid material. When you cut it, the liquid flows out, and that is why it's called liquefactive necrosis. You can only see the walls of this. So if you look at the walls of a liquefactive necrosis of brain, you'll find that there are jitter cells. Jitter cells are macrophages which have ingested the digested lipids. So macrophages with foamy cytoplasm along the edges. The liquefied part, of course, will flow out. Here also you can see jitter cells. This is a lung which has an abscess. So in this, bacteria has come and caused an abscess. On the walls, you can see portions of the liquefied material still, but the main part of the liquid flows out. If you take a section, you can still see these are the acute inflammatory cells which are lining the hole or the cavity of the abscess. Here, a little bit of the necrotic material still seen. It is still sticking. Most of it will flow out. So normal lung has been replaced by this. So this part is the liquefactive necrosis. And if you see this area, some areas where there it is still present, you can see it is full of neutrophils. Neutrophils means it has three dots nuclei. So I told you about caseous necrosis. Caseous means it is like cottage cheese or paneer. So this yellow area over here is a tubercular lung in which there is caseous necrosis. So if you touch it in a fresh specimen, it will crumple like paneer. It is because of a combination. So in tuberculosis, sometimes a liquefactive process can predominate, sometimes a coagulative process can predominate, sometimes the bacterial proteins hold things together. If the liquefactive process is more, you will get a cold abscess. We call it a cold abscess because it is less inflamed, but the macrophages will get digested and a liquefied abscess will form. More commonly, you get caseous necrosis where the immunity is good. Caseous necrosis on microscopy is structureless, amorphous. The outlines are not there. There is something pink, but that's all you can make out. The cell outlines are no longer there. So caseous is a gross term, not so much a microscopic term. This is the counterpart of caseous necrosis. Here also you can see there is an inflammation which you will study later called granulomatous inflammation. And in the center of that, there is caseous necrosis, amorphous, structureless. Here also you can see some giant cells, and this is the caseous necrosis.
Excuse me, sir, yeah. What exactly is like an abscess, like to be exact?
So an abscess is an area which has undergone liquefaction. So inflammatory cells come to the site of an inflammation, which we'll be doing in a later class. But to put it concisely, they come there to try and kill the bacteria. And in the process of killing the bacteria, they release the neutrophil contents, which are the lysosomal enzymes. So lipases, collagenases, proteases, nucleases are all released. So the normal tissue of the human body is also digested. And therefore, it forms a cavity which is full of digested liquefied material. And that is an abscess. Got it?
So that cold abscess thing that you mentioned in liquefactive necrosis.
Okay, cold abscess is a part of tuberculosis. So normal tuberculosis has caseous necrosis. But in cold abscess, which is a type of tuberculosis, the liquefactive process predominates more. Typically seen after you give treatment to a patient of tuberculosis, you or otherwise, if there is a cold abscess because of certain changes in immunity, when there is less immunity, for example, there are more macrophages and less of granulomas. So granuloma function is to sequester the tubercle bacilli within it, prevent blood and its content from reaching inside, because the tubercle bacillus is a microaerophilic, oxygen-loving species. To contain the if the macrophage eats it, it is not able to deal with it because it has virulence factors which make the mycobacterium live inside the macrophage also. And so you have to wall off the area. By walling off, you reduce the blood flow. So the inner part of the granuloma will undergo a process of necrosis where FAS ligand will kill the phagocytes which contain the microorganism, that is mycobacteria, which get released outside. And the lack of blood supply makes a peculiar shrinkage type of thing, so that it becomes like a coagulated cottage cheese-like process. But in certain situations, the liquefactive process of FAS ligand killing the macrophage becomes more. And therefore, the liquefaction produces a cold abscess. It is cold because it is not acutely inflamed. Unlike an abscess which has acute inflammation, it's a hot abscess. If you touch it, it'll feel warm. Cold abscess, if you touch it, it'll feel cold. Because this is a different process of liquefaction as compared to neutrophils. You'll study all this in your inflammation class. So the last few slides, there is a kind of necrosis called enzymic fat necrosis, where if your pancreas is damaged, for example, in pancreatitis, pancreatic lipases come out, and in the peripancreatic fat or in the mesenteric fat, they will lipases will digest the triglycerides to create free fatty acids, which will saponify with calcium present in the blood. And so you get gritty calcium deposits. So if you look at it, normal fat is vacant like this. Once it is saponified, it becomes pink like this, and calcium, which is blue, will also get deposited here. And so this is a marker of enzymic fat necrosis. This is an area of inflammation which is also present. Here also you can see that there is enzymic fat necrosis. So the normal fat is now looking like enzymic fat necrosis. So it's a kind of fat necrosis, necrosis of fat cells. Similarly, if you have trauma to a fat containing area like breast, you get traumatic fat necrosis. Trauma ruptures the fat cells. Macrophages get attracted to this. The macrophages take up the extra fat. And so in early traumatic fat necrosis, the interstices of the lipid tissue or adipose tissue is having 4B macrophages here. Later on, there is sometimes liquefaction of these macrophages and the material gets deposited like a abscess. So you can get a liquefied area also in traumatic fat necrosis. The last process is gangrene. Gangrene is an infarction. Infarction we saw is coagulative necrosis due to loss of blood supply or ischemia. A gangrene is an infarction complicated by histolytic actions of bacteria. So two types of gangrene are described in surgery. One is dry gangrene, which is a surgical term for infarction of a limb. Infarction means blood supply lost. There is no complication by histolytic actions of bacteria. So in pathologic term, this is infarction. The whole thing has discolored and become infarcted. So if you take a section, the nuclei would be lost. The skin nuclei, the muscle nuclei, nerve nuclei, all will be lost. So that is infarction. This is wet gangrene. Wet gangrene means there is superadded histolytic actions of bacteria. There's an infection by bacteria which release histolysins, which will dissolve the tissue and cause inflammation, typically seen in diabetes. So in diabetes, you get this wet gangrene. And this is a specimen you will be given in this image in situ during operation. This is normal intestine. This is gangrene of intestine. Whenever there's infarction of intestine, bacteria is always present. And so they always produce gangrene. And after fixation, it becomes black like this. Okay, so this is a area of necrosis in which, because of the histolytic actions of bacteria, it becomes discolored and black in the flesh as well as in the fixed tissue. So you'll be seeing specimens of these in your subsequent classes. So I've come to the end of this lecture where I've told you the hypoxic model of cell injury and the importance of ATP depletion, how the mitochondria is important for reversible versus irreversible injury. What is cloudy swelling, that is early reversible injury, cell swelling from which it can recover. I've talked about the free radical damage and the reperfusion injury. What is necrosis? What is its gross morphology, that is coagulative or tombstone necrosis? The karyopycnosis, karyorrhexis and karyolysis. Cytoplasmic eosinophilia and nuclear loss. Coagulative, liquefactive, caseous and enzymic fat necrosis. These are types of necrosis and gangrene. So I've come to the end of this lecture and you all are free to ask any questions that you